very glad to be here and very humbled to be here. And this has been a long time since I was last here. And in this very room, I attended my master among the faculty members of Professor Jama Toke, Professor Rambal, Professor Duran, and there were a couple of other professors here. It's quite nostalgic for me to be here, and I am a very proud member of Indian Technical University, and a very proud member of graduates of Indian Technical University and Electrical Engineering College. Now, my professors, most of them have retired, but my colleagues have picked up the flag and then furthered the reputation of the Electrical Engineering program. I'm very glad to be part of this community, and very glad to be here, seeing you like I was once sitting there and listening to the talks given by the scientific team. So if I get excited, please forgive me, because this is the first time after 40 years I am giving this lecture, you know. So, the topic, complete picture of dispersion relation for SPP. How many of you know what SPP is? Okay, good. Surface plasmon polarity, they call it. All of these things come from electromagnetics. Once you know electromagnetics, you know everything. That's what Sanjay Hoja would tell us. You know, that's the reason why we all selected this field, because one of them know everything. And we learned electromagnetics, and we started doing some work, and those work took me recently to this new topic in optics, surface plasmon polarities. Those are nothing but electromagnetic waves coupled with electron density of matter. So, I'm going to get there in a minute, just to tell you what this abbreviation means. I just give you a heads up. So, my talk would have an introduction part and a long introduction part, because I know that this topic is new for most of you, and I need to introduce better. And then, dispersion relation. You know what dispersion relations are, right? I thought I knew it, and I learned that I didn't know it, and then I started working on it, and we did become some new interpretation of dispersion relation. So hopefully you know it, and by the end of this talk, you realize that what you know is not enough. Okay? Then current consensus, or confusion, perhaps. You know, there are lots of confusions on the definition of dispersion relation, and I'm going to show them one by one, and then tell you what our interpretation is. And result, there is not much math. Okay, when I took the antenna course from Professor Viran in the graduate school, we had to see lots of equations, integrals, and do things, and then combining those equations with practical application of antenna. Here, I am not going to give you an equation, unfortunately. I am just going to give you some physical interpretation of what this dispersion relation is. So, at the end, you are going to see nice pictures, three-dimensional pictures. You may not relate to anything, but at least the pictures are nice. I can tell you that. So this is what surface plasmon polarities are. These are electrons in a metal. You shine a light, then you excite those electrons. So what is different? I mean, there's nothing new. We all know that, right? If you shine a light on a metal, of course electrons would be distorted. like itself. They move together. Light and electrons oscillate together. So that's what surface plasma plasmons are. Why do they call plasmons? I have no idea, because perhaps they want to make it like photons, you know, the particle energy particle. Fluorophore is an electromagnetic wave attached to the surface with a specific energy. You can call it plasmon to make it a particle-like name. Okay? So, I already told you this. Incident light disturbs the electrons. Electrons are plasma, right? Because once you have a million trillions of electrons on the surface, you call them plasma, right? So, the disturbance travels along the surface of the metal. This coupling of light and electron is called SPP. That's what the SPP is. So, coupling of light and the density of electrons. That's all there. There's nothing new. And it's a simple electromagnetic wave propagating at the interface of dielectric and metal. Okay, so here is the another picture describing what surface plasmons are. Here is an electromagnetic wave. This is metal and propagates along x direction, tangential to the surface. So some of you may wonder what the difference is between surface plasma polariton and surface waves. How many of you know the surface waves in layered media? Okay, not many. But, okay, there are other surface waves. When I first read this, I said, this another surface wave. I mean, they are coming up with new names, catchy names, so that they can sell, sorry, they can publish their papers. Okay, so I thought that, but then I realized that there is a slight difference from the ordinary surface waves that we are used to seeing, we are used to studying. So, actually, in this case, surface waves are completely trapped in the surface. If you remember the other surface waves, they are trapped in the surface on the air side, but on the dielectric side, they are guided. So here, these surface waves are completely trapped, decaying in both directions. So it is strange, right? Because you have a wave decaying in both directions, and how are you going to excite that? Because it shows that propagating wave cannot excite that. Because if the propagating wave was exciting it, then this wave would have a propagating component in air direction, so in the air region or metal region. So, since the wave is decaying in both directions, then how are they going to excite those waves? I'm going to get there in a minute. But at least, you get the picture, right? This is what surface plasmons are, trapped in the surface. But there are other features of surface plasmons that are very useful in today's applications. Okay. So, before I go further, I needed to describe the dispersion relation. Okay? There's a toy example, 1D wavelength, which you all know that, and second derivative is time, most term, and second derivative is space. This is a wave equation with loss, right? This is a one-dimensional. It is propagating along x direction and uniform in other directions, so one-dimensional wave in a lossy medium. Okay, this is the wave equation. You can derive it from Maxwell's equations, very simple. So, how are we going to solve this? Okay, there are ways to solve this, and I'm sure you have taken differential equation course before, but since this is a partial differential equation, there are two very well. The best way, and for me the simplest way, is separation of variables. You all know that, right? Separation of variables. What I do here is that I split this unknown into two functions multiplied. U of x and u of t, separation of variables. But we cannot here, I'm just applying it without telling you what the boundary conditions are. Please bear with me. Take my word that the separation variables work for this problem. Okay? So, when you do that, you come up with two parts of these solutions, ux and ut. Those are the separated functions, right? And we all know that the solutions are in exponential form in space and exponential form in time. Okay? So, when you put that into here, you come up with something like this ugly-looking equation. That doesn't look pretty friendly because there are square roots and squares and things like that. But if you remember the dispersion relation is something that you guess the solution. You remember the plane waves? You write e to the jkr plus j omega t. This is your mode. This is your mode, right? You plug this into the wave equation, come up with an algebraic equation, something like this. That's what the dispersion relation is. So, here we learned what dispersion relation is. But just note that this relation, this alpha and beta, are nothing but the eigenvalues of this wave equation. Eigenvalue pairs. I need to know alpha and beta to pinpoint my solution among this many solutions, right? So this equation actually tells you the set of alpha and betas that would provide you the solution. So that's the pair of eigenvalues. That's what dispersion relations are. They are giving you an equation of eigenvalues for which your equation is satisfied by these solutions. Okay, so I think it is clear. Now let me move forward to go along this structure again. Here is the dielectric material. Here is metal, the incident light, reflected ones, and transmitted ones. You all know that, but metals in optics are defined by this Drude model, they call it. This is an complex and different looking epsilon, and in RF, in radio frequencies, metals are white, perfectly reflected, right? Everything reflects from metal. But in optics, it's not the case. In optics, when you go to optical frequencies, metals would have a dielectric constant, something like this. You can get this from Lorentz force equation, very simple. But it is not the scope of this talk, but this, the epsilon m, is used by this equation. Okay? If you solve, okay, this is the dispersion relation for surface platforms, and I jumped into the solution, okay? But we learned how to get the dispersion relation, right? How am I going to get this? I'm going to send a plane wave, and calculate the reflection, look at the minimum of the reflection, where I would have the singularities of dispersion, singularities of surface wave, right? Because since if there will be a coupling to the surface wave, then your energy of incidence will be lost to the surface wave, therefore you would see a dip in the reflection coefficient. So that's what we do, but analytically you can do that, analytically right here, and magnetic field, Hy, right here, magnetic field, force it to decay in both directions, then you will come up with this one, into your fourth step. But then you know that this has to be satisfied in order to have a dispersion, in order to have a surface plasmon here. So the derivation of this one is quite simple, just do your four steps, starting with magnetic field at the interface, forcing it to decay in both directions, and that's it. Okay, now if you plug this right? This is what omega k, the dispersion relation. If you had to plot just the dispersion relation in dielectric, homogeneous dielectric, infinite dielectric, the green line is called white line, which is what you can write k in terms of omega. K equals omega over c, right? K is linear function of omega. This is what it is, right? But the wave here should satisfy this relation. If you plot this on this one, you see k of this surface plasmon is larger than k of light. In other words, any propagating wave cannot excite this one, because k of this one is larger than light line. If you consider kz, this is the z direction. Well, how do you write kz? Kz equals square root k squared minus kx squared. Since kx is larger than k0, then you have an imaginary component and you have a perfectly decaying, right? And therefore, none of the propagating plane wave can excite the surface plasmon on the surface. But this is the dispersion relation. When you plot it, it turns out to be coming like this, and here it bends back and goes like this. This is what light line is. Now, what is the importance of this wave? Why we are trying to understand STPs? Because of this. You see, when the k on the surface wave is large, what does that mean in terms of wavelength? If k is large, the wavelength is small, right? Do you know the resolution limit of any lens in optics? Number 2, right? You can resolve 2 points by using just an optical lens if they are separated by lambda over 2 or more, right? That's what the resolution limit is. If you generate an electromagnetic wave with a larger wavelength, with a smaller wavelength, larger k, smaller wavelength, half of that wavelength is quite small. Therefore, it can beat the resolution limit. You know, the optic lenses work in the visible spectrum between 400 nanometer up to 700 nanometer. So the smallest distance you can resolve is 200 nanometers. But if you wanna go to the 50 nanometers, you cannot use any optic lens. But here, you can use, if you can generate the surface plasmons and excite any molecules here by this electromagnetic wave, which has much smaller wavelength than the optic wave. So that's the main reason why people try to understand surface plasmon polariton, because the wavelengths are small, and also you enhance the electromagnetic waves at the infinite. So, features of SPPs, confinement of electromagnetic fields. You see, they decay in either direction. They are confined at the surface. All the energy is confined at the surface. Once they are confined at the surface, you can excite molecules or atoms sitting on the surface. Then you can detect what there is on the surface. Okay? Enhancement of electromagnetic fields. Here, since the wave is concentrated at the interface, decaying in both directions, therefore you enhance the electromagnetic waves, fields at the interface, right? They decay in both directions. 2 harmonic wavelengths. You see here, long wavelength signal gets in, and very short wavelength signal propagates in this wavelength. These are applications. I'm going to show you a few more. And and sensors, for example, you light the source. This is the metal. On this side, you have antibody and antigen here. This antibody is connected to those molecules. When they are connected, you will have a shift in this resonance frequencies or in the surface plasma molecule wavelength. When you have the shift, you understand how much of these antibodies are attached to this antigen. So these are related to molecular observation of some disease or some illness that people are working with. And photovoltaic cells, you put metals here. So what is the reason why you use photovoltaics? To convert light energy to electrical energy, right? So what we do is shine a light. Light gets into this active region. How much it stays there, how long it stays there, it generates pluses and minuses, volts and electrons, right? So you want to trap the light inside this active region in order to get higher current. So, but if you don't use anything, light will come in, most of it will go back. So we put some metal spheres, they resonate at the resonance of surface plasmons, and when they resonate, it heats the environment, and therefore it generates more volts and electrons. Therefore, we get better current. Okay. So another thing, cancer treatment. And if you send those nanometals into the tissue where you have tumor, and then you excite from outside, send laser light, those spheres will resonate and will heat up the environment where they sit in, so they kill the tumor. Okay? So all those things are some applications of surface plasma polaritons. And now let's get back to dispersion relation. Giving you the flavor of where they are used. Now we go back to the boring stuff. Okay, dispersion relation. We are back here. This is the relation, right? I assume that we derive this. This is the geometry. And if the metal is lossless, if you pick this gamma zero, then the metal will be lossless. 1 minus omega p squared divided by omega squared, right? There is no loss. If it is lossless, dispersion relation will look like this. This light line again. What does this point mean? Infinite precision, resolution. It means that lambda goes to zero, wavelength goes to zero. You can actually get a picture of nanometer with no problem. Infinite resolution. There must be something wrong, right? It is not possible to have infinite resolution, right? Okay, so people started using this as the dispersion relation of SPPs. But if you have a loss, which is inevitable in metal, right? Since you have a metal, there are lots of loss. So then, if gamma is different from zero, we see this backband thing. We get better resolution here, and we observe the backband if we have a loss. Now, I'm going to give you some discussion on this. I call it confusion. In 1973, they said that, okay, this is light line. We measured SPPs, goes like this, and bends back. At the time, this was the first observation of backbend. They said there must be something wrong because it should go to infinity. They didn't understand this. They said there is a backbend reason. This is the geometry. How do they excite SPP here? This is a dielectric material. They send the propagating wave, therefore they cannot excite SPP here. Propagating wave cannot excite SPP because Kx of this one cannot match the KSPP. If it cannot match, it cannot excite. therefore, this reflects, there is an evanescent wave inside which matches the Kx of the SPP at the metal air interface here. You are generating SPP here, not here. Okay? This is called as Kretschmann modulation to excite SPP. Because we know that if you send a propagating wave, it can never excite SPP here because K cannot match. This is called momentum match. Okay? So, here the dispersion curve was found to bend back toward the light line instead of increasing asymptotically to surface plasma energy at infinite momentum. That was the kind of confusion at the time. They felt that it should go to infinity. I don't know how they think that it should go to infinity. To me, it seems not physical. Okay? So, following this, they another experiment, they said that, okay, if you draw the reflectance on that geometry, with respect to frequency and angle of incidence, energy in proportion to frequency, right? Frequency and angle of incidence, you see such a surface of reflectance. Depending upon which one is kept constant, either angle of incidence is kept constant or energy is kept constant, you observe either this or this backpack. They were telling you that if you fix omega, search for theta for resonance, or if you fix theta, search for omega for resonance, you observe two different dispersion relations. So that's the confusion. Okay, you have a single expression, very simple expression, like this one. Very simple expression. You perform experiment, you fix angle, search for frequency for resonance, or you fix frequency of incidence, search for K for resonance, you get two different curves. And they call it, this is fixed theta, this is fixed omega curve. Okay. This is almost the same thing. Let me go fast. We go back to the original analytical expression, right? This is KSPP analytic. This is epsilon of the material. We substitute in here and we draw omega versus KSPP when we keep K real, omega complex. We get this one. K real omega complex from this equation. When we keep omega real K complex, we get this expression. So from same expression, this is the same expression. Analytically, they write a small MATLAB code, you get this and this. Right? So if you fix omega to a real number, you see backbending. If you fix K to a real number, you see infinite resolution. Then people claim that, okay, since infinite resolution is not physical, so let's stick with real omega. Okay, which one is correct? So here is in 2006, they applied this to periodic structures. The correct choice, they said, real K complex omega. And no, the correct choice is real omega complex K. It is in 2010. And in 2011, no, both are correct. Real omega complex K, real K complex K. So, why? No explanation. So, here again, 1986, they applied this to a grating, which is supposed to have a band gap. Then constant theta provided the band gap, constant omega did not provide a band gap. Just the opposite of the other one. You remember, real omega was giving the back bending. Here, real omega was giving no band gap. Therefore, they say real omega is not the right choice. So there is a lot of confusion. Okay, So they did lots of other things, and I put them here, all those examples, so that they, even for the simple equation, okay, that simple equation, people up until 2016 could not get in the same, on the same page. Someone were saying, okay, real omega complex game, someone were saying real k complex omega, and here, let me, in this book, it's a very nice book. It explains surface plasma electrons well, explains the surface and astronomical spectroscopy well. It is a very thorough, very analytical, and very nice written book. But even in that book, it says that, let me read it, the first and most common approach is to consider omega real, which leads to K being complex. Even this sentence makes me cringe, makes me, you know, kind of not comfortable. What do you mean by common approach? Aren't we doing applied math? Aren't we doing things based on mathematics? They say common approach. Then the second approach is to take K real, which leads to complex frequency. Of course, if you take one of them real, the other one will be complex, because then take them, right? The wave has to damp, the wave has to attenuate, and if you keep all real, nothing will damp, and then you are using wrong solution. So then they tell you the solution. They tell you that if an elementary excitation is maintained over time by an external source, then it is logical to take omega. I hate this word, logical. What do you mean by logical? Are we doing logic in this electrical and electronics engineering program? Of course you do sometimes, but here, this is a deterministic system. We deal with classical physics. We don't care about those, you know, probabilistic quantum approach for the time being. Of course we care, but for this problem, we don't care. So everything should be deterministic. What do I mean by logic? Okay, then it is logical to take omega real k complex. If an elementary excitation is created within time by an external source, then it is more logical, right, to take omega complex and k. So this was these were the papers that put us into this problem. When we let these, actually my student, Serhat Tehko, he convinced me to work on this. I gave him different problems, more practical, and he said that, no, there seems to be a problem in this one because people are confused. And I let him work, and he did a good job, and he came up with nice explanation. I'm going to provide you in a minute. Okay. How am I doing? Okay, so I shouldn't keep you longer, so you'll hate me if I keep you. Observation out of our study. Okay, I'm going to show you them, but this is the conclusion in the middle. Both K and omega can be complex. What is preventing us assigning complex values to both? Nobody questions. Everybody thought either omega must be real or k must be real. I don't know why. Experiments do not correspond to any old analytical solution. They do experiments, I will show you in a minute. One cannot eliminate solutions based on physical intuition. Those are the three conclusions that we came up with. And if you draw this, we did nothing mathematical. Okay, there is no mathematics behind it. We took just this dispersion relation, and we said that K and omega both can be complex. This is imaginary part of omega as a functional real part of K and real part of omega. This is imaginary part of K, real part of K and real. Who is telling me that I have to fix omega to real or K to real? Nobody. And I will show you mathematically that nobody tells us which one is real, which one is complex. Okay, this 3D view is animated. Let me see if I can. So if you look at the picture on a 3D view, you see that actually there is a very rich curve that you can use for this one. I'm not going to show this one, this is another one. For this, these were two-way reading, right? Actually, and then now, in order to do the experiment, you need to have a three-way method, one dielectric or another dielectric, right? That's the practical problem. This is three-layer. In a three-layer medium, it looks like this surface. It's complicated. I'm not going to go into detail, but the bottom line is that dispersion relation is not a line. It's a whole set of surface. I'll show you. Okay, that's that one.
Then the lost term goes into the frequency. Okay,
Some of you may think, isn't that contradiction there? Spatial laws. The laws in the medium were both on the temporal curve, like e to the j omega t. You would expect the laws to be in k. You understand what I'm saying? So the medium here, lossy. But since both ends are fixed, the k turns out to be real, because cosine pi over pi x, right? Cosine pi x. So k is pi. But since it is lossy, loss should appear in the frequency, which is in temporal time, right? The how can you sleep with this? When I read this, and I had to think, you know, there must be something wrong, because the loss in the medium is buried into the time term, e to the journey of e. Then I realized that spring problem, you know the spring problem? If you fix the spring between two fixed walls, make it oscillate. What happens to the oscillation? Dance, right? It gets smaller, smaller in time and in space. Space-wise, the boundary condition fixes you a real k, real eigenvalue, but the frequency has to be complex in order to get the damping in time. So then when I realize this, I start sleeping better. So then we went to this. Okay, this is k is real, alpha is for the omega is complex. We generate another one, semi-infinite geometry, but the initial condition f of t is source pulling. This is source, complex, right? Attenuating sinusoidal. So omega turns out to be a minus plus ib. If you write it into the geometry of ct complex, this turns out to be omega, and theta turns out to be complex again from this version. So bottom line, when we did this, we submit the paper, and we have comments that, look man, we have been doing this v omega for a long time, and there is no reason why we need to believe what you say. Something like this, I am exaggerating what you said, but they didn't believe what we came up with. They still thought that omega should be real. Recently, just a couple months ago, right? They gave us this toy example, actually this toy example belonged to the review. He showed this, but he didn't show that. Then we introduced this example. We said that, look, in this example, you use cavity. In my problem, layer D, you use open problem. There's no relation. And with open problem, this is better representation. You see both can have complex vectors. Then the same reviewer wrote us back saying that, look, okay, I understand what you are saying, but actually you need to expand this in terms of real frequencies using Fourier series or Fourier transform. Those real frequencies would actually be your real omega and the complex beta. So he was just telling us that you write this in terms of real frequencies. People, he might have a point, he didn't agree with me, but he might have a point, and we did. We wrote this source input as a Fourier transform. It's Fourier transform. It is a omega field. This is your source input. Okay, you know it's Fourier transform, very simple. You have a unit in that function. And we did this, integrating around omega 1, this limit from around one. Okay, this is my centrifuge. One, integrating it. Then I increase the interval slightly. We observe that this solution converges to that complex field. Okay, let me show you one more thing. So here, this one, the exact solution that we use complex on it, right? That's reviewed in the media. This is exact solution. This is the integration, Fourier transform, using real fields. So this is when you pick a single point at the carrier frequency, which is one, you get this pure sinusoid, which is not equal to the this one. If I increase the interval of integration here around 1, you see the difference between the two is this. You exactly get the complex. Therefore, we are saying that that omega complex is exact solution, which is defined by single complex. If you believe in writing in real frequencies, go ahead and write that in real frequencies, but you will end up with the same solution. So when you are looking at the dispersion, you have to look at the complex omega and complex k. Future work, complex omega, how do we generate signals with complex omega and complex k? Because if we can generate complex omega, it seems to be trivial for electronics, but for optics it is not. And if you can control the imaginary part of your source, then you can choose any path on that dispersion surface. You can actually reduce the resolution limit further. You cannot make it infinite resolution or the zero point, but you can improve the resolution further if you can engineer the source, or if you can engineer the dispersion dimension. Okay, so I'm not going to go in here. That's all what I need to explain. But before you go over it, I have to tell you that when you, I told you in the middle of something. If you have a question, I told you that you'll get the reflection, you'll get the minimum of the reflection to find it. But anyone who has taken systems course knows that the singularity of transfer function is a whole, right? But I'm looking at the zero reflection. One of them is this medium. Okay, I'm confusing you to make you go and look at it. It is well understood from the branch point, and you know, I'm sure you know the proper Riemann sheet, improper Riemann sheet, and when you go there, if you don't bother, but if you are interested in, you will know what the difference is when you are going to look for whole or when you are going to look for zero. If you are in the proper Riemann sheet, you have to look for all on the infrared Riemann sheet, hole appears as zero. So when we are taking the path, actually we are taking the path in the infrared Riemann sheet, that's what we are looking for zero. That's the reason why we look at the reflection minimum. Okay, thank you for being here and bearing with me during this boring talk, but if you have any questions, I can answer.
How do we exactly simulation model.
In a what?
Simulation environment.
Simulation environment. Just send the normal plane wave and put a dent in the metal. Because the dent in the metal will act like a dipole, which gives rise to all sets of k's that will excite surface environment. Or put a sphere on top of metal. Sphere will act like a dipole, which generates again all the wave numbers you want. Yes, you go a little further from the dipole or the sphere, whatever you have, a little further, whatever survives along the surface will be the surface plasmon wave.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay.
Thank you.
There's